Respected Dr. Shashi Thakur, Professor Rajkumar, Vice Chancellor of the University, Professor Dr. Stephen P. Marks, other eminent people on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, and students, good evening. It indeed gives me a great pleasure to preside over the first Professor Dr. N.R. Madhav Menon Memorial Lecture, and I appreciate this initiative of the University in remembering Professor Menon in the most apt manner possible by creating a new avenue to continue a dialogue about the law. I had the privilege of being a student in the Delhi University. We had a number of eminent people there, including Dr. Madhav Menon, and persons like Professor Tripathi, Dr. Upendra Bakshi, and Professor Latika Sarkar, among the many. Let me begin by first attributing an unfairness of process to the organizers of this event by putting me to speak after Dr. Shashi Tharoor, who is my senior from college and one of the most articulate persons to express his point of view. But then we were taught to deal with difficult situations. So be it. Professor Madhav Menon was a man of many achievements and fondly regarded as the father of modern legal education in India. Spearheaded a legal education movement in India at a time when legal education systems were facing a considerable credibility of crisis. He was committed to bringing legal education in India at par with global standards, a visionary idea which saw fruition with conceptualization of a 5-year integrated law course. His pursuit of improving the standards in legal education was not limited to law schools. For aspiring lawyers, for he served as the founding director of the National Judicial Academy in Bhopal from 2003 to 2006, as part of another admirable venture to ensure de rigueur training of judicial officers. For his remarkable efforts, Professor Menon was posthumously awarded the Padma Bhushan in 2020, after having been previously awarded the Padma Shri in 2003. The philosophy behind Professor Menon's many pursuits was to create social engineers who would go out in the world and contribute towards improving access to justice, as well as the quality of justice for the common man and women. While Professor Menon laid the groundwork, it is upon young adults like yourselves, the students, to strive and stride towards fulfilling his philosophy. Law and the idea of India, interesting issue. India as we know it today began with an idea, to have a tryst with destiny, to break free from colonial rule and to embrace the ideals of a democracy through a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. This idea eventually led to the culmination of the Indian freedom struggle on the midnight hours of the 15th of August 1947, where we promised to ourselves to step out from the old to the new. While India's relatively young democratic history has had its own sets of ebbs and flows, challenges and triumphs, this promise has stood ground because we have always been a nation committed to democratic ideals of justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity. The very moorings of idea of a modern India as codified through the heart of the Constitution of India, the preamble. The preamble memorializes our collective aspirations. It contains the very principle that precondition the possibility for our unity and integrity as a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. B.R. Ambedkar, in his concluding speech before the Constituent Assembly of India, resonated with the text of the preamble to urge that India has to aspire to be a political as well as social democratic republic. To quote him, "Political democracy cannot last unless there lies at the base a social democracy." What does democracy mean? It means a way of life which recognizes liberty, equality, and fraternity, which are not to be treated as separate items in a trinity. They form a union of trinity in the sense that the divorce one from the other is to defeat the very purpose of democracy. Liberty cannot be divorced from equality, equality cannot be divorced from liberty, nor can liberty and equality be divorced from fraternity. The preamble, as a fundamental part of the Constitution, represents the pulse and soul of the nation. and epitomizes the Constitution's philosophy, objectives, and basic structure features. The Constitution itself is a living document, and to be living, it must be growing. The Constitution must be elastic enough to meet the needs and requirements of a changing world. It can best do some by maintaining its roots in the past, while continuing to live and grow in the present for an unknown tomorrow. In order to understand the future of the Constitution better, one must always maintain a connection with the past. Maintaining this connection is possible by ensuring that the growth of the Constitution primarily stems from interactions between three of its components: the text, the courts in interpreting and enforcing this text, we, the people, through a representative legislature in supplementing this text. In the context of the Constitution being a living document, Justice Bhagwati in National Textiles case fittingly commented, "We cannot allow the dead hand of the past to stifle the growth of the living present. Law cannot stand still. It must change with the changing social concepts and values. If the bark that protects the tree fails to grow and expand along with the tree, it will either choke the tree, or if it is a living tree, it will shed that bark and grow a new living bark for itself. Similarly, if law fails to respond to the needs of the changing society, then either it will stifle the growth of the society and choke its progress, or if the society is vigorous enough, it will cast away the law which stands in the way of its growth. Law must therefore constantly be on the move, adapting itself to the fast-changing society and not lag behind." As a dynamic and growing document, the judiciary has often ensured that this dynamism complements the changing strides of Indian society and culture. This can be seen right from the 1970s, which witnessed the delineation of the basic structure doctrine and the expansion of the right to life to the 2000s, which witnessed the decriminalization of same-sex relations and established privacy as a fundamental right. Given that legal systems stand in a particularly complex relationship with culture, does law shape the idea of India, or does the idea of India dictate the course of law it takes? Legal institutions are responsive to social change, but are equally responsible for being instruments that set off or facilitate change. Law is multidimensional. It reflects the values and assumptions of lawmakers, its functions in formal and informal setups. It enters into our personal lives, and it relates to some of the most important social issues and movements of our time. The role of law in the modern societies has to be understood in a comprehensive manner, both as an ever-evolving reflection of the direction in which society moves, as also a device to induce social change. American jurist Paul Freund once said, "The courts should never be influenced by the weather of the day, but inevitably they will be influenced by the climate of the era." To remain objective in the face of overpowering public discourse, whilst also being cognizant of the changes in public thought, is an onerous task, but sacrosanct duty of the courts as custodians of law. The Supreme Court in 2017 ruled for the first time that there was a constitutional right to privacy. 2018, responding to a series of petitions, the Supreme Court declared 377 of the Indian Penal Code, which criminalized same-sex relations, to be unconstitutional in cases of consensual adult relationship. In another judgment, the court held the criminal offense of adultery was unconstitutional on the ground that it discriminated against women. Most recently, the Supreme Court passed the verdict granting permanent commission and command position for women officers in the Indian Armed Forces, an aspect close to me because I wrote the first judgment in the High Court on the subject. These cases are among the many others that have, over the years, played a crucial role in bolstering the identity of India and us as Indians. They act as instances where law has sometimes affirmed the ideals that we as society stand for, and at other times given us new principles to aspire to. What runs as the common thread among these cases however, is a two-directional flow and synergy between what happens behind and beyond the courtroom doors. As the Constitution receives increasing interpretations that respond to the demands of time, even in the moment of judicial activism, the instances of constitutional leaps and expansions are based on the preamble and purposive reading of the Constitution. Despite being enacted more than 70 years ago, the same are still relevant and fundamental today. The relevance, and rather indispensability, of the Constitutional Charter entered into at the time of independence and the principles that emanate therefrom stem from the basic ideal that were considered to form the foundation of the constitutional journey of India since its very inception. A commitment is needed to such ideals that resonate with a basic constitutional promise, which also remains alive to the changing nature of demands while passing time and varying circumstances. In the debates, the founders of our Constitution, we sense a tone of caution regarding the continued existence of democratic fabric of the nation, with Ambedkar saying that democracy in India is only a top dressing on an Indian soil, which is essentially undemocratic. This note of apprehension results in invoking of the Greek stalwart Crote, who had memorialized the idea of constitutional morality, an aspect which has witnessed repeated recognitions by the Indian judiciary. Two, especially in recent times, in the case of Navtej Singh, that is the decriminalization of homosexuality, and the triple talaq case. In the case of Manoj Narula, Union of India, Justice Mishra captures the sentiments of what the idea of constitutional morality envisages as: the Constitution of India is a living instrument with capabilities of enormous dynamism. It is a constitution made for a progressive society. Working of such constitution depends upon the prevalent atmosphere and conditions. Dr. Ambedkar had throughout the debate felt that the Constitution can live and grow on the bedrock of constitutional morality. Speaking on the same, he said, "Constitutional morality is not a natural sentiment. It has to be cultivated. We must realize that our people have yet to learn it." Constitutional morality as a concept inheres in itself a longing commitment of the people of a country to the different forms the Constitution takes with passage of time. At the same time, this concept serves as a reminder to the formal dispensation that while balancing rights, a mere adherence to the voice of majority or to the more vociferous voice is not necessarily constitutionally correct decision. In fact, a repeated recognition of majoritarian preference and demand alone, especially while interpreting and balancing rights, can result in crisis of trust and faith of other groups of the society in the Constitution and in the representatives of the state who interpret and enact the same. Thus, the idea of constitutional morality rarely rises upon tradition amongst both those governed and those who govern, or straying to the founding commitment that was entered into and to abide by constitutional parameters and uphold the constitutional ethos. However, with every varying understanding of a perfect basket of rights suited for any country, especially a country as heterogeneous as ours, it is impossible to peg a particular set of rights to reflect the idea of India that is to be shown everlasting commitment towards. Temporal changes too contribute to the inevitable conclusion that the idea of India and the role law plays in it cannot be static. The idea has to grow with time while still being rooted to that which is essential to the very existence of India. The idea of constitutional morality is an ode to preserving the essence, essential components to the existence of India. It anticipates the supreme importance in a constitutional order ought to be given to a space for all within the system to air their ideas and demands without any backlash. The idea is not that the demands of all are to be necessarily met by formal dispensation methods, which is quite impossible. Rather, the idea which finds place in the Constituent Assembly debates as well is that since no single government can ever purport to take care of or represent every single person. A free and accessible space is to be provided to every section of the society to put forth their views. Thus, the basic ethos of the nation is sustained on the idea of a participative democracy, which needs to be ensured and protected by all organs of the state. It is only when such participation is allowed and encouraged that people across the nation will feel united as a country and loyal to a document that speaks to them and of them. In fact, while discussing the issue of rights of homosexuals, the Supreme Court, while striking down Section 377, observed, "When a penal provision is challenged as being violative of the fundamental right of a section of the society, notwithstanding the fact whether the said section of society is a minority or a majority, the magna cum laude and creditable principle of constitutional morality in a constitutional democracy like ours, where the rule of law prevails, must not be allowed to be trampled by obscure notions of social morality which have no legal tenability. The concept of constitutional morality would serve as an aid for the court to arrive at a just decision, which would be in consonance with the constitutional rights of the citizens, however small that fragment of populace may be. The idea of number in this context is meaningless, like a zero on the left side of any number." It is with such encapsulation that one is able to realize the importance of concepts like an organic constitution and constitutional morality. Of supreme importance is a constitutional system that is not shackled by commitments of the past and traditions of yore. While taking along with the customs prevalent, it is the duty of the legal system to instill, provoke, embellish that change in the social fabric that is perceived as basic to the existence of various sections of the population, irrespective of the numbers that perceive such need. What is important is that the dialogue between all the segments of the population and the formal dispensations of state authority has to be built within the formal modes of the justice dispensation and has to be a regular occurrence within the formal system itself. It is this that shall ensure a responsive and participative society. This places an onus on both citizens and the state to ensure that an air of tolerance and environment of dialogue and discussion prevails. Quite a few instances of inflamed passion can be diffused if we just remember to be tolerant to the views of others and work towards a remedy that takes all along with. Inspiration can also be taken from the models adopted in countries like South Africa, where seemingly irreconcilable differences were to a large extent bridged with the help of restorative justice and reconciliation approach to the Truth and Reconciliation Committees. It is often more important to realign focus from the prosecution of individuals in an adversarial setting to creating a healing environment that seeks to understand the experiences of people while taking into account administrative limitations. By creating an environment that focuses thus on the demands and needs of people, such committees, and inherently a model of restorative justice, can become a more systematic part of the justice delivery system. Such a system makes the citizens a true and active participant in the outcome that affects them most. By becoming a stakeholder and, in fact, a leader in the decision, citizens become owners of their own destiny and feel more integrated with the legal system. Law, by using its methods to create such environment of acceptance, can help to actualize the true idea of India. Thus, an idea of India and its identity is continuously evolving. The 21st century is an age of cross-cultural influence, of diffusion of ideas and borrowings of systems and mechanisms. Today, when students of law study constitutional law, they may not necessarily perceive the law and what it could do for them in the same manner as it may have been perceived 70, 30, or even 10 years ago. While the vision of founding fathers of our constitution has stood the test of time, its application and accommodation of the changing and ever-evolving aspirations to be shared onus among a civil society, lawmakers, and guardians of the law as we jointly take on the momentous task that we committed ourselves to. The result that we as society yield are necessarily to be committed collective effort founded on and supported by a robust legal regime that gives us access, agency, and due process. I would like to again commend the university for conceptualizing this memorial lecture and making it a reality. I am confident that in becoming a regular event, this lecture will give a fitting ode to a man who dedicated his life to the noble cause of education. Thank you, and Jai Hind.